Good morning, beautiful morning. It's so good to be together, to be back. Today, I want to talk about something that maybe you've been thinking about, but it seems to be a common theme in people's lives that I have met with over the past few weeks, and I thought it would be important to talk about. And that is the persistent patterns of negative thoughts. I think so many of us, especially those of us who are dealing with what's going on in the world, you don't have to name it all, there's various things going on, and there seems to be right now these patterns of negative thinking. There's a nasty inner voice that's demotivating us from pursuing our best life. And sometimes these thoughts, if you can relate to it, they won't go away no matter how much we reason with them. Logic doesn't work. And we're fully aware that these self-defeating ideas are completely irrational. But it doesn't help. No matter what we do, we can't seem to get rid of these arguments that happen in our head. I was thinking about it because I was taking a look at various narratives. My favorite narratives to look at is the Bible, the Torah, and the various stories there, and trying to understand what those stories mean in our lives. Because the Torah is not just a history book. We don't know very much, actually, about the characters of the Torah. We know very specific stories about them, but we don't really know their lives. People think, oh, it's just a history book of an ancient history book. It's actually it's Milashon Hora'ah. It's a lesson. It's a book full of life lessons. And so I've been trying to take out various life lessons. I've been doing this for a very long time, but recently I find it more important, especially since there's a lot of revisionist history going on, taking these characters and trying to understand life lessons from them. So I want to focus for a moment on the story of the Exodus from Egypt. I figured it's a good idea anyway, because I don't want to remind anyone, but Passover is about 6.5 weeks away. And so I thought maybe, though Purim is beforehand, and we'll talk about Purim, I hope, soon, but maybe it's something that we can start thinking about. So the story of the Exodus from Egypt, I think, is a really great example of how to deal with negative thinking. Pharaoh in the narrative is the very personification of evil. He's complete selfishness, a total lack of so much as a capacity for empathy. His extreme ego was so out of control that he considered himself a deity. He considered himself a god. And when Hashem sends Moses to speak to him, nothing had yet proven him wrong. He was at the very height of his power. His narcissism was still working for him. So there was nothing, absolutely nothing, that you could tell him that would make him listen to anyone else's point of view. It was literally like talking to the wall. And I think that if you look at the narrative between Pharaoh and Moses over the course of the time that Moses was going and trying to help the freed, you know, to free the Jews, to free the Israelites, it aptly describes what the ego can become when it becomes particularly entrenched in stubborn, irrational thought. So the key to successful communicating with Pharaoh is also the secret to the most unreasonable part of ourselves. If we understand how Moses spoke to Pharaoh, we're going to understand how to approach the ego when it becomes unreceptive to the logic or to reason. So before the confrontation with Pharaoh, Hashem tells Moshe the following. You shall repeat, these are the words in Exodus 7:2. You shall repeat before Pharaoh everything I shall command you. Rashi explains that exactly as Moses hears it from Hashem in Hebrew. What? Pharaoh speaks Hebrew? What's the point? A question I've had for years. What's the point of Moses speaking to Pharaoh in a language he didn't understand? Nothing against the Chinese, but if somebody came over to me speaking in Mandarin, I would say to please use one of the languages I do know. But Moses goes to Pharaoh, and he is speaking to him in a language he doesn't understand. And then the same Rashi explains that Aaron would translate the words of Moses afterward. Now this makes the question even greater. If Aaron is the interpreter, let him speak. Why is Moses speaking altogether? And why did Pharaoh, the Pharaoh of Egypt, have to sit through a speech he didn't understand before he could hear the message? It's not like Moses was just making up the words on the spot. He knew the message. He got the message from God. He knew it before he went to the palace. So why couldn't Moses just tell that message to Aaron and then say, Aaron, you be the interpreter. We know the message already. Hashem gave it to us. Just say it in Egyptian to Pharaoh. These are my conundrums, my biblical conundrums. I'm having a good time actually over here. You're getting into my head a little bit. These are the kind of things I think about. I don't know what you think about, but these are things that I think about on a regular basis. In the 1890s, the Polish government issued a ban against shechita. Shechita is the Hebrew word for the ritual slaughter of animals. And all the wise and eloquent leaders of the Jewish community tried to carefully explain to the government that shechita was not, cruel to animals. Actually, whatever they tried, there was no argument that was accepted. One of the great rabbis of the time, his name was the Chafetz Chaim, Rabbi Israel Meir Kagan. He went to a group of high-ranking Polish officials to plead with them to rescind the decree. If they would enact it, it would cause a tremendous hardship for Polish Jews. It's not like today they couldn't fly in meat from somewhere else. It means that people would not have meat to eat. And the Chafetz Chaim couldn't speak Polish. Well, he spoke a little bit, but not well. And so he pleaded his case passionately before these ministers in Yiddish. The ministers didn't understand a word he said. And when the Chafetz Chaim finished, an official government interpreter stepped forward to translate the words from Yiddish to Polish. The head of the group of officials, obviously not Jewish, said, stop. No need to translate. We understand. And with that, the ban was lifted. That's the story. No need to translate. We understand. The impassioned, the enthusiasm, the way he spoke was enough to convince them. The words didn't matter. Have you ever heard of the 738-55 rule? Then is this familiar to anyone? So the 738-55 rule, you should look it up. It comes from a study by a professor at UCLA in the 70s. It found that a speaker's influence on their listeners is based 7% on words, 38% on body language, and 55% on tone of voice. I'm going to say that again. 7% on words, on what they're actually, the content of what they're actually saying. 38% on body language, which is why I hate being behind a Zoom camera. I love, now that I've been spending the past few weeks in front of live audiences, I like it much better. But I know that our community here would have a hard time with us all being in the same room every Thursday. And 55% on tone of voice. That means that most of what people hear is not what we say, but how we say it. Most of what people hear is not what we say. If I could tell this to parents, I wish I could say this to every parent in the world. It's not what we say, it's how we say it. And as the study observed, nonverbal elements are particularly important for communicating feelings, for communicating attitudes. When they're incongruent with the message, it's a problem. Which means if the words and the body language contradict each other, the listener is going to believe the speaker's body language more than his words. If you notice it, you're going to see a lot of people who will go like this. Yes, yes, I believe you. I understand you. While shaking their head the other way. You'll notice it. I notice it a lot. If the speaker's body language is incongruent with their words, the body language will win. So, if you sit down, let's say, with your friend or your spouse or anyone, and say, you have my total attention, or your child, while you're staring off into space, or you tell your friend, no hurry, no hurry, we have plenty of time, and then you're pacing back and forth and looking at your watch, or you tell your child, never do that again, but you're laughing. In each of these cases, the real message that the listener understands is the unspoken one rather than the spoken one. You could say, never do that again while laughing all you want, and the child will not listen. And you wonder, why don't they listen to us? They don't listen to us because our words are incongruent with our body language. Now, obviously, words also matter. Using words that make sense and are faithful to your message is very, very important. But we can't only rely on how we say things and not pay attention to what we say. But in some cases, for example, the story of the Chafetz Chaim and the Polish officials, words don't matter at all. It's not what you say, but how you say it. And when is that story most important? When dealing with Pharaoh. And I'm not talking about the Pharaoh 2,500 years ago. I'm talking about the Pharaoh in your heart. Pharaoh does not listen to reason. The power of logic against the Pharaoh and all the Pharaohs out there. And you know who I'm talking about. The modern day Pharaohs. There's Pharaoh within and there's Pharaohs all over the world right now. The power of logic is useless against these pharaohs. I wouldn't even try. And that's why Hashem tells Moshe to repeat verbatim in Hebrew the exact words that he heard from him. The purpose was not to reason with Pharaoh, not to get him to understand, because Pharaoh could not be reasoned with. The Pharaoh cannot understand. The only purpose of Moses' message was to break the power of Pharaoh's ego through the display of godly might. That was the point of the 10 plagues. That was the point of the entire narrative. Moses is simply the conduit. So when Hashem sends Moses on this mission to rebuke Pharaoh in Hebrew, I think it's important to think about what he says before that mission. This is in Exodus chapter 7, verse 1, right in the beginning of the mission. He says, see, I have made you a master over Pharaoh, and Aaron, your brother, will be your interpreter. You shall repeat before Pharaoh everything that I command you. The word master here, and this is the Kabbalah that I wanted to bring out this morning, is Elohim, meaning God. In other words, Hashem says to Moses, you as a human cannot speak to Pharaoh. No human can speak to him. So you're not going to speak to him. I, Hashem, am going to speak to him through you. Don't even bother interpreting. Only after Moses had unleashed the quote-unquote wrath of God upon Pharaoh, without any explanations, was it possible for now Aaron to interpret. Moses repeated exactly what God said in the tone, in the intonation, in the feeling, in the body language, whatever that means. And then Aaron can interpret the words, because the words are only 7% anyway. So here's my thought. The path of self-refinement often involves talking to our selfish side in words that it relates to, in words that our ego can understand. And we carefully explain the pros, the cons, the different decisions. We try to persuade the animalistic urges to come along with us, trying to make them feel the higher calling. These are integral parts of working on oneself. And there are times when the ego is out of control. So Pharaoh, the Pharaoh within us, the ego just is out of control. It won't listen to reason. So we don't even try. Instead, what do? We unleash the pure truth, the pure emet. I love the word emet, because emet is made up of three letters, aleph, mem, and tav. Aleph is the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet, mem is the middle letter, and tav is the last letter. That's what truth is. The Hebrew language is not just a random language. Everything is so perfect in it. And so emet is unleashing that pure truth without adapting it, without editing it, without watering it down. We say it like it is, and we don't worry whether it makes sense to the ego, because that's not our mission. In other words, rather than trying to argue with these thoughts, speak to them in Hebrew and don't translate. Oh, you don't know Hebrew? Speak to them in truth. We tell the ego things so lofty, so holy, so pure that it couldn't possibly understand. And that's okay, because the goal is not to make it understand. Like Moses speaking Hebrew to Pharaoh, or the Chafetz Chaim speaking Yiddish to the Polish officials. The point is to channel God's pure truth as it is without holding back. When we're particularly stubborn, when irrational thought attempts to argue with us, refuse to take the bait. Instead, say loudly and proudly, Am Yisrael Chai, the nation of Israel lives. We answer to a higher power. We answer to a higher calling. Our souls, every single one of us, in the entire world, are infinitely powerful. Now, ego, let me do my mission. Don't explain yourself. Don't rationalize it. Don't try to say, oh, but the plight of this, the plight of that, that's not our job right now. Our job is not to rationalize various plights. Normally, in regular circumstances, when we're able to, we can talk to the ego. We can use reason. We can explain to our lower self why what it wants is not really good for it, and why what it doesn't want is actually good for it. That's normally. But there are times, and times such as the times that we're in, and I know you know what I'm talking about, that the ego, like Pharaoh, it's riding high in Egypt, and nobody can say anything. There's no reasoning with it. And in this case, right now, we have no choice but to unleash a holy cry of truth. There's a beautiful statement that we studied. We study every morning, for those of you who have the opportunity right after this class to join us for Talmud. We studied not long ago in the Talmud. There was a statement in the Talmud and Brachot that we're studying. The Olam Yargiz Adam Yitzro Hatov Al Yitzro Hara. It says there, one should incite the good inclination to rage against the evil inclination. That's the job. Incite. Like rage. That's HR, happiness and rage. Incite the good inclination to rage against the evil inclination. And it's important, I think, to note that the word li'olam, which is in this the first word of the statement in the Talmud, doesn't mean always, as it does in the Torah. It means, as often goes in the Talmud, actually. One should not always rage the evil inclination. That's a bad idea. That causes a lot of other problems. This is not something that you do all the time. You do it when you need it. And the beauty is that our sages in the Talmud are teaching that although anger is such a negative trait, there is actually a time and place when it's appropriate. And that time and place is anger against the unchecked Pharaoh, like ego. There's the ego within and the ego not within. So even though on a regular day we try to avoid anger, in general, le'olam, actually, there's a case where it's useful when it's aimed inwardly at the ego that just won't listen to reason. And with that, we have to use the body language. 7% is the words. We have to use the body language. We have to use the intonation, the voice. So, right now, for those of us who are dealing with our internal pharaohs, or the pharaohs that are not so internal, that are screaming in the streets, I think rather than getting trapped in another pointless argument, I think it's time that we just say our truth. We say it in the present. We be proud of it. We don't back away. We don't have to be bashful. And sometimes we can say it with anger and rage, because that's how Pharaoh listens. That's how Pharaoh responds. And that's our job right now. Whether it's within or not within, we have to proclaim our truth and not be bashful about it. And whether the Pharaoh is able to relate to such ideas or not, I think there's a time for translation, and I don't think the time is now. And there's a time to just let Moses speak the words of God. There's a time for us to just say the words. We don't have to explain it. We don't have to interpret it. We don't have to justify it. We just have to speak it and be proud of it and not back down. Those are my thoughts for today, and I can't wait to go to questions and hear your comments and ideas. So for those of you who are not going to be listening to this live, we're going to turn off the recording, and you should know that we're here together every Thursday, God willing, at 9 o'clock Eastern. And then you can have some words in edgewise, like everybody else that's going to, about now.